afternoon. The August 11, 2015 meeting of the Marion County School Board is called to order. For the courtesy of those listening to the meeting, I'm requesting everyone in the audience to please turn off your electronic devices or put them on vibrate. And I'd like to ask any gentlemen in the audience to please remove their hat. Later in the meeting, up to 30 minutes will be provided for individuals to address the board on matters concerning the operation of the Marion County School System or the school board only. Presentations to the board are limited to 5 minutes and are televised. If you wish to address the board regarding a regular agenda item or matters on which the board customarily takes action, you must first complete a peach sheet located on the front table. If you wish to address the board regarding a public hearing or student discipline matter, please complete a lime green form. These forms must be fully completed and received by the board secretary no later than 5:40 p.m. The procedures applicable for each are on a separate sheet. Madam Secretary, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Bobby James, District 3.
Here.
Mrs. Kelly King, District 5.
Here.
Mrs. Nancy Stacy, District 1.
Here.
Mrs. Carol Ely, District 2.
Present.
Ms. Angie Boynton, District 4.
Here.
Mr. Stephen Lake, Board Attorney.
Here.
Mr. George Thomas, Superintendent.
Here.
Thank you, ma'am. Mrs. Erin Howe, Social Studies Curriculum Specialist, please introduce the Social Studies Teachers of the Year who will be providing the inspiration and lead us in a pledge this evening.
Thank you very much for having us tonight. Kenneth Edmison is going to lead us in the pledge.
Will you please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
Again, thank you for having us here tonight. I'm very pleased to bring to you four amazing teachers, social studies teachers from our district. At the end of last school year, we've done this for many years, the Marion Council for Social Studies asked for nominations from the community, from teachers, from students on who they think is the best teacher. We take those nominations and the council passed teachers of the year and district personnel decide on three, one from elementary school, one from middle, and one from high. So I'm honored to present them to you. Carla Nebesnik, Kenneth Edmondson, Regina Johnson, and Bethany Crawford. Carla Nebesnik is a National Board Certified Teacher. She teaches fourth grade at Ward Highlands Elementary. She is also a Golden Apple recipient and has been a Teacher of the Year at both Ward Highlands and at Bellevue Middle School. In addition to her classroom instruction of social studies, she really tries to make it a hands-on experience. Her students have been to the Civil War reenactment at Silver River and seen artifacts there from the Florida homesteaders and Native Americans. They go to St. Augustine, which is probably the highlight for every fourth grader, that very rich history in St. Augustine. And I have interacted with veterans by singing songs at the Veterans Park. Carla also organizes, outside of her social studies instruction, the entire fourth grade musical, which they then perform for the school and for parents in the community. Kenneth Edmondson teaches seventh grade civics at North Marion Middle. He is the lead teacher for North Marion Middle and is one of the most active participants in PD that I think I've ever met. Anything I offer, I know he's already on the list, which includes book studies, leading PLCs at his school, mentoring new teachers, reviewing and revising curriculum materials, supporting his faculty in administration and technology for the classroom, collaborating with his colleagues from around the county, and attending conferences all around the country. He co-founded the 21st Century Program that helps to tutor students, and he also founded and is the advisor of the Middle School Gentlemen of Quality Group, GQ, at North Marion Middle, which centers on using effective intervention and personal empowerment to support at-risk boys with a focus on accountability and mentorship. Regina Johnson, she teaches 11th grade U.S. history at North Marion High School, so we got the whole North End up here. She has a very high level of expectation for her students and is consistently rigorous, and she has a great ability to motivate her students to take ownership of their learning, which is sometimes difficult in 11th grade. And this has impacted them both in the classroom and outside of the classroom. She provides an excellent blend of high-quality instruction that incorporates reading and writing and collaboration on a daily basis. By integrating kinesthetic learning entwined with historical empathy, her students are able to grasp a true appreciation for history. Regina differentiates her instruction to meet the needs for her students, which includes visuals, reenactments, firsthand accounts, and high-level academic conversations, some good debates, to help her students understand key historical events. She has impacted students and teachers outside of the classroom as well by mentoring new teachers. She has also been a lead teacher for social studies and attends lots of professional development, has helped on curriculum projects, and attended state conferences. She is truly dedicated, and we can see that. Last but not least, I'm sure I don't need to really introduce her, but Bethany Crawford. I asked her to join us tonight because she was last year's Teacher of the Year for Social Studies for high school. And as the Golden Apple recipient this year, I wanted to join her fellow Social Studies teachers up here as another thank you and highlight Social Studies again. These teachers really are the extension of all of our social studies teachers. They do a lot of really hard work, and they really deserve our thanks and gratitude for all that they do in helping our kids become better citizens and critical thinkers and questioners of history, policy, and society. So that, I thank you.
Oh, and thank you, but I want to thank all of the recipients, you know, but exactly what you were saying, it's really a joy for me to be able to thank you and say it's appreciated for what you do for our students. I really thank you so much, and I'm sure some other board members have something they want to say. Mrs. Ealy?
I want to tell you that one of my grandchildren's favorite subject in school is social studies, and because that teacher, in more than 1 year, has made social studies come alive, dressing like a different historical figure, that just really intrigues kids and makes them want to learn and want to love social studies. But thank you so much for what you're doing and for leading Marion County students this year as well.
Mr. James?
When I first got into education, I'm a social studies teacher. People always say, well, he's in physical education, but my first tour of duty was on B-Wing at Forest High School as a social studies teacher. And the thing that I really enjoyed about social studies was the fact that we could actually get our kids engaged with what is really happening in the world and what has happened. Mm-hmm. I know when I look at you guys, I know when I was there, I got excited about teaching history because it just made things come alive, and kids could understand how one section of our history led to the next section and on and on. It's an ongoing process, and I just want to say, hey, you all people of my heart, because I really enjoyed my time in social studies, and I got my degree in social studies as well. So when you want somebody to come in and talk about American history sometime, let me know. Thank you.
You got his name?
I'm good.
I just want to say thank you. Mr. James says that social studies is close to his heart, but it's close to my heart also, as my husband is a history teacher and high school. And you guys are exemplary teachers, and we're just grateful and thankful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. King. Mrs. Stacy.
I'd like to say that the teachers that the students choose, to me, that's what says it all. I have one son who didn't really like school a lot, my middle child. And it was a struggle to get him there his whole life. Today, he's doing great, thanks to all of y'all, but goodness gracious, when he was in first grade, I thought he was gonna be quitting by the time he was in second grade. He actually was a preschool dropout. He hated it so bad. But as he got up into high school, he began talking about some teachers that he really liked. And I didn't know that they even made an impression on him, because all he thought about when he got there each day was getting back home with mom. And so that came, some things didn't come through about school, but that favorite teacher did. And so it really impresses me. And then my older son, he was just completely different. And everything that always happened, it was the teacher's fault, not his. You know how that goes. And so I used to say to him, Major, they don't get up every day to see if they can make your day miserable. You really are not that significant in their life, you know? But today, now that he's all grown up, he talks about his favorite school teachers all the way through school. And I could just sit here and name them. And so even with him, with his little stubborn streak about school, he remembers his teachers. In fact, the teacher that he had the most problem with one time, I said, I think it's because you remind him of me, because you have his number and I do too. But you teachers, when a student chooses you, wow, you know, that's where it's really at, because they will remember you for life. And I bet you the President of the United States, the congressmen, they can all tell you their favorite teachers through school. And someday there's going to be someone in this district that goes to the top, goes somewhere where they're really famous, and they're gonna say your name someday on TV, and you're gonna go, wow, I can't believe that. So just wait, it'll happen. Congratulations.
Thank you, Ms. Stacy. Mr. James.
Just one other thing I just wanted to say. When we made our biggest movement in test scores and reading, I believe it was done through our social studies classes, because there was so much reading, and the kids were so excited about what they were reading, and the social studies teacher had blended in with what we were doing. And it was just amazing what occurred in our social studies class. And I know you guys know how important your classes are, but the reading was the thing that really just pushed us over the top, and it came from our social studies department. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Board. Thank you, Aaron.
Thank you.
And thank you. Mr. Superintendent.
Board, I recommend approval of the agenda for the August 11, 2015 school board meeting with the materials in the board packet. Those materials distributed to board members at the meeting, the audio recording and DVD included as part of the official record of the meeting.
May I have a motion on the superintendent's recommendation?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved by Mr. James, seconded by Mrs. King. Is there any discussion? Call the question. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, like sign. And the motion passes. I just want to say here, congratulations and thanks a lot to Brenda for our minutes are caught up. So we don't have any today to approve. So. Individuals who have completed the appropriate form prior to 5:40 p.m. will now have the opportunity to address the board. Before you begin your presentation, it is required that you state your name and address for the record. Additionally, please spell your last name. Matters dealing with student discipline, including expulsions, will be scheduled at the conclusion of the televised portion of this meeting. Parents wishing to address the board regarding a discipline matter will have the opportunity to do so at that time. I will now ask the school board's attorney to explain some additional points.
Thank you, Ms. Boynton. If you plan to address the school board tonight, you need to be aware of the school board procedures. Copies of those procedures are available from Mr. Christian or from one of the front tables. Under the school board's procedures, AV presentations are permitted if you provide them at least 48 hours prior to the meeting to the school board's assistant. AV presentations are limited to a total of 5 minutes. The use of any student's name except by his or her parents or guardian, or identifying references to or identification of other students and their families, is strictly prohibited. Based on time considerations, the school board by majority vote may rightfully limit the number of presentations on any one topic, shorten the presentation time, move public comment time to a different position on the agenda, or eliminate the public comment time altogether. Ms. Boynton?
Thank you, sir. Madam Secretary, do we have any speakers tonight?
Mr. Sampson?
My apologies. I only brought six to Attorney Lake. Sorry, I only brought six. It's okay. I don't need any.
Thank you.
My name is James Sampson, S-A-M-P-S-O-N. I preside at 2341 Southeast 186 Terrace in Silver Springs. I'm talking to you tonight about an event. I bumped into you in Publix, and I look like this because I was in the ice cream section and you in the healthy vegetables section. What are you, about 6'3", 215? That's Ali when he won the gold medal. Well, I need you at this event, and I'd like you to get in the ring, and I'd like you to tell some of the kids there that if they get bullied and their teacher doesn't do anything, you're the heavyweight. And if you're free that night, I'd love to have you get in our ring. I also want to thank Mr. James, Bobby James. He's been very helpful with my event. Kelly King has secured something as silly as carpet, and I got to say rug because people don't pronounce the pronunciation of carpet from Boston. But and Nancy has actually read the Resource Officer of the Year Award. Very quickly, this is our third year. The resource officers this year are listed there. They've done a hell of a job. I only got involved in this because I found out that when Mark Vianello, who's one of your best employees, was the principal at East Marion, someone was bending my little boy's fingers on the bus every day. And he never told me until later. Well, now he works at Lockheed Martin, and he's one of the fighters you see in the pictures. Nobody bullies him anymore. But I read an article in Ocala magazine that said 17% are reporting this. The remediation you guys got for the problem is excellent. You're professionals. But you got a hot enough job probably keeping these places safe without worrying about some of the stuff that's going on. And it's appalling and it's unacceptable to me that 17% are reporting it. So that's why I try to do the anti-bullying pledge. And Ed McPadden and Kathy Bryant don't understand boxing very much. They go, I don't like it. But they both helped me. Mr. McPadden came through with the captains of the football teams. And I've only got seven calls, I'll be honest with you, over the last three, 4 years. But one mother called me and told me that a football player walked up to a bunch of kids at the bus stop, but they were beating the kid up every day and said, hey, I took a pledge. He said, don't do that anymore. That's wrong. I'm going to tell the teachers. I'm going to tell the resource officer. And he said, it's none of your business. And the kid said, I took a pledge. The other parents that call me, pretty much the same thing. Unfortunately, I was in Tampa when a little 12-year-old girl jumped off a tower. I was working down there. And it was the other stuff, the cyberbullying stuff. So I just would like some help, and I'm going to close real quick. I got the items I need help with. I'm getting rugs. Chester Gregory said I can go pick them up. That's awesome. So the venue will look really good. We have flags from all the countries of the kids that are coming in, from Atlanta, California, Miami, Tampa, Orlando. Community service. I need as many kids as you can get. I think we need them. These USA boxing books, which carry the $1 million insurance on each kid, it takes me forever to go through 100 kids that are coming in because we're only going to use maybe 32 of them, but categorizing them is really tough. And Superintendent Tom, and I think I've already talked about, you're in pretty good shape and my shape is round, but if you're not doing anything that night, I'd really appreciate it. Any announcement, this is free. These events don't make any money. We had 2,800 at the gate last time, and I put about 6,000 to 8,000 in it. But I get grants. I get help from Marine Corps generals and people that they know the bullying's a problem. I just want to thank you all very much, especially Nancy and Kelly and Mr. James for your help with the events. And I hope Chairperson Boynton, you can make it, and Ms. Eli, you can make it. And of course, George, I want you in there. I have you wait. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Madam Secretary?
Let me.
Mr. James?
I had an opportunity to go out after this Samson event, and it's really heartwarming to see all those kids stand up and take the pledge. And if you haven't had an opportunity to go out to attend this event, it's really a neat process. And it's just good for kids to see everybody working on something that we really of developing programs to prevent. So it's one of these things where I just want to give him hats off for his effort, because that's a job well done out there.
I'm Ms. Stacy.
I'd like to say something also. People don't understand that sometimes boxing and taekwondo and martial arts, you know, they think of it as they're fighting. But it's better to have them get their frustrations out when they're supervised and they learn, you know, the proper skills of how to do things. And I know with my own son, he was a black belt in martial arts, and by the time he was 9 or 10 years old. And my mother commented to the sensei one day and said, I don't really like the idea of these boys fighting like this. And I don't think it's good to teach them to fight, because it's going to make them go out and fight other kids. And the master said to my mom, do you know anyone that wants to pick on a black belt? Who is he going to fight? And if I hear that he's fighting, he gets belts stripped from him. He's to go to authority. And they teach that in these organized fighting groups, these guys, these boys that want to fight. And probably being in an organized fighting situation with martial arts probably could be the thing that saved my oldest son's life, because he was a fighter. He just wanted to fight. And when he was 5 years old, I said, if you're going to fight, I'm going to put you someplace where you can fight 3 nights a week and just get it out of your system. And he did. And it got out of his system. He fought there. He didn't fight in school. It went on to make him a really good football player, because it taught him a lot of technique, because he really was kind of small for the position that he played. But he used his technique, and he used the discipline that he learned fighting. And he also stood up for kids in school. I'll never forget some stories he shared with me, particularly at Osceola, where he stood up for kids who were being picked on. And he said, if you want to fight somebody, probably you should come downtown where I go to my martial arts. I'll take you on. I'm a black belt, and you need to leave that kid alone. And we'll just peel it off. And the bullies in the school at Osceola began calling my son Tiger. My son got real excited. We called him Tiger. But he was known for taking care of kids because he was a fighter, and he did it the right way. And thank you for teaching these kids, because all of those little boys that fight, I guarantee you, you're teaching them about bullying, and they're going to make sure that they go to authority, because when it's organized fighting, they're taught to go to authority. That's the way they're taught, and they will handle it properly. And so thank you for what you do. I appreciate it.
Ms. Haley?
Mr. Sampson, could you tell us again, I know you've got August 27th, 6 to 9 p.m. Where is it being located? I wanted the public to know.
Oh, it'll be at the Southeast Livestock Pavilion.
Southeast Livestock Pavilion.
Yes.
Okay. And they can just come. They don't have to.
All kids are in free to take the pledge.
August 22nd, 6 to 9 p.m.
It's very
Livestock
safe.
Pavilion. Okay,
very safe. We have 20 SWAT team members working the corners.
Oh,
they can't talk to the fighters.
That's pretty safe.
The coaches
yeah.
are pretty strict about
it. Okay. How much is the adult?
An adult ticket is a $10 donation, but we don't really turn anybody away.
Okay, okay, great. Thank you very much.
Yes. Before you go, you mentioned the pledge. Can you tell them what type of pledge this will be for our students?
Yes, so you have a copy of it.
Yes, I do.
In the package, yes. And the pledge simply states that if you see bullying, you know, the governor yelled at me about boxes and bullying. What do you have, the boxes mark out the bully? I said, no, governor. They just stand by the victim and tell them this is not right. I'm going to tell the resource officer. I'm going to tell the teacher. Because you've got to tell them. You guys have a tough enough job trying to keep this, educating these kids. You know, and that, I'm just trying to help out a little bit with that 17% figure that's so appalling.
Let me just help Ms. Stanton out a little bit. What I noticed that was the most important thing was not necessarily what was going on in the ring, but what was going on outside the ring in reference to all these dignitaries and people there. Supporting the anti-bullying campaign, because we had at some point we had a speaker to stop the whole shebang and really talk with the kids about the importance of recognizing bullying. So I think it was more than just what was going on in the ring, but it was what was being said and what was being taught at this particular event. So again, it was just. You see kids in the ring, but it was only for a short period of time. And then there were breaks where people would actually stand up, and the resource officers that we have in our school districts was there as well. So again, it was something that was well done.
Yes, it's wonderful. And our most courageous fighter is Mark Herndon, who's a running back for the Gators. And he's an Outback Scholar Athlete of the Year, Forest graduate. Devin Decker from Vanguard, who is now United States Marine. Most courageous fight, you know what that means? They lost. You know? And it is a wonderful... Your job is so tough. I could never do it.
Mr. Sampson, is this being videotaped? I'm thinking, you know, to bring it into the schools because we can't have all of our students there that night.
I have $11 on me. I owe $250 for the trophies.
Okay.
I'm getting, you know, I mean, you have no idea how hard it is to put this together.
Okay.
And I'm going to try to get someone to videotape it, but he wants $300, and we're trying to raise funds for that. And we have a lot of the newspaper people coming.
Okay.
From The Voice in Bellevue, they do big spreads. Star Banner, The Citizen, did a 2-page article about us. And but as far as having a professional video, I do have someone I'm trying to. He does videotape for the county commission, I think. But we beat him down to $300. We're still beating on him a little bit. But
okay.
Yeah, it's I'm very, very proud. I would never be able to do it without everybody's help. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt. This Marion County is awesome. I wouldn't want your job. I've been in these schools. I helped build Westport. It's like Fort Knox, and it has to be. You know, we all know what happened up in Rhode Island, and that's why I wanted to start recognizing these resource officers. And this year it's Ronnie Williams from Vanguard, who I met at Howard Middle with my little 16-year-old. They'll have the portable jail cell there, too, who I'm going to make my 16-year-old sit in there for a little while. She's a pain in the butt, but... And then Daniel Moore, I don't know where he works, but he's a deputy. And I'm just very thankful. I want to share everything with you guys and let the kids know it's free.
Well, thank you for all your efforts.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Secretary.
Mr. Domenzas.
Good evening, Board.
Good evening, sir.
Charles Domenzas, P.O. Box 4230, Ocala, Florida. Last name spelled D-E-M-E-N-Z, as in zebra, E-S. I'm getting a handout right now, and I'll wait till you get out. But in the meantime, I'll tell you that I'm here with our two board members and our school administrator. Situation as it stands right now. We have to get insurance, well, I should say, we've gotten insurance, and your packet, the small 3-page packet, the first page, or the first and second page, are excerpts from our contract with the county, with you all, I'm sure, with the district. First page states that we have to indemnify the school board by the charter school, which we're doing, okay? It's in the charter. And that's really the main thing on the first page. Second page talks about insurance and bonds. And it states right below Exhibit 2 what we have to have insurance coverage. I won't go through the detail because the point what I'm getting at here is the very last line, sexual abuse, molestation, and harassment. It does not state an amount. All it says is we have to have insurance coverage. The last page is a certificate of insurance. The certificate of insurance on the right-hand side shows all the different coverages. And on the bottom, right below paragraph E, says that we have abuse and molestation endorsement, 100 incident limit, 300 aggregate limit. So basically, we do have the insurance. Risk management is insisting that we should have $1 million insurance on the basis that we had been having that for the last 6 years because it was very cheap, not because we were necessarily going by our contract. At this point, to get $1 million in molestation, sexual harassment, it will run anywhere. I've got two bids, one for $75,000 and another one for $89,000. And that would mean that our total insurance liability would be in excess of $100,000. We can't afford it. So at this point, a decision by this board has to be made. And according to our contract, the third paragraph says, Second, Marion County School Board would not unreasonably withhold insurance acceptance. And so unless you want to close us up, we can't afford to get $1 million policy.
Before you say something, Mr. Davis, I'm going to ask our attorney at this moment. It's still with this contract, and it is about insurance liability. What do you recommend to the board?
Well, I can offer some brief comments at the beginning. I'm very generally familiar with the issue. I'm in discussions with Ms. Stacy and Lori Lively. I've not been asked to conduct a full contracts analysis on this issue, nor have I conducted one. I will make two points, though. My general initial impression is that this is not a black and white issue in terms of contract analysis, that this would require a very careful analysis based on all the facts, including the course of performance between the parties over the years. So that's a lawyerly response, I guess. Second, that there is a dispute resolution process built into the contract, which the parties are required to follow, which has sort of an escalating steps in terms of written communications, and then if that is not successful, then using the dispute resolution mechanisms available under the Florida statutes, including mediation. So there are those requirements in there, but hopefully the parties can reach agreement prior to that being required. So I will do whatever the board directs me to do on this, but those are my initial general impressions of this contract issue.
Mr. Superintendent, do you have anything you would like to say on this?
My summary comments would be that you are all aware of this situation, and I've read the contract also. Mrs. Lively is here tonight. I am not in any position, nor am I interested in waiving or changing those liability requirements. This is what we require all of our charter schools to do. This is what Francis Marion Military Academy has done for a number of years. They have secured the appropriate certificate of liability insurance. It's very clear to me that it is understood that that was an acceptable requirement, and they have paid this. As you were all aware, there is an outstanding case involving an issue involving one of their employees, and you know that we have also sought advice from our insurance advisor, Ben Few, who advises us in this whole issue, and he has advised us, as I have shared with you, that we stick with the liability requirements of $1 million per incident. I can think of no one else that is a greater expert than he on this whole case. He has nothing to gain from this. He is our expert. You respect his opinion on all other issues. I'm not sure why we wouldn't respect his opinion in this one also. I do not know about the cost of the insurance. I don't know anything about that. That is between the charter school and their agent, and I'm assuming what Mr. Domenzis is telling you is an accurate reflection of what he's been billed. I have no idea about that. But I certainly support our ongoing requirements that we have the $1 million policy in place for this particular category.
All right, thank you, Mr. Superintendent. Stacy?
Okay. First of all, I looked at this contract. It really is, like our school board attorney said, it's a little bit in the gray zone. When it talks about the sexual abuse molestation, that's kind of like an extra rider that we've asked for. You know, we've asked for the extra coverage. We do not have a number in there. But we have to have it, but it doesn't say how much. I know in business, a lot of times you can get a policy and it covers like a whole lot, like a little pocket of things, and the insurance agency just gives it to you. It's not really a whole lot more to have different little things added onto it. And I know in our construction company, there's a lot of times with the city of Ocala or different places where we might have a contract on a project that says, you know, it's $1 million required. This was in years past, $1 million required general liability, where they might say, you know, well, this is kind of a tough one. Could you, you know, make sure you have your coverage in? Because all the bidders know that they have to supply that. Well, my husband's policy happened to have, the one that he supplied just happened to always apply $2 million. And so he did that. But when the construction industry plummeted, My husband had to drop back to his $1 million coverage of required coverage. He could no longer offer the bonus of the extra million to just because he had been doing it, because it's, you know, his contract didn't require it, but it was part of his insurance packet that he could do it. So the given the fact board, if you read this contract, we are completely held harmless. Anything that happens over there, according to this contract, and I guess state statute backs us up also, the sponsor is held harmless. So whether they have insurance, if they had zero insurance and something happened, it's no skin off our nose, because it doesn't affect us in any way, because we are held harmless by the contract and the statutes. So this insurance is really to cover the anatomy of the charter school, not ours, because nothing that happens will affect us. Now, what we do know by this contract is that it does not have a limit, required limit on here. Just because we put it in some of the other charter schools' contracts doesn't really have any, that's kind of like saying, you know, well, you have to have this amount of homeowners insurance because everybody on your street has it. It really doesn't, that's not the way a contract goes. If we wanted an amount, it should have been in here, and it was not. Just because we remembered and put it in the middle school contract, well, you know, that's, we should have revised this, and we did not. But I go back to the fact that, regardless, it will not affect this school board. This is only to protect. And so one of our employees said, well, you would think that they would want to do it. Well, you know, when times are good, we want to overinsure ourselves sometimes. But when times are bad, we drop back to the bare minimum. And one thing Mr. Attorney and I talked about was the fact that this is in the gray zone. And yes, it might could go to court if the charter school, if the school board held them to that, we could go to court. But I also asked the school board attorney, who would win? He doesn't know. So are we gonna use taxpayer dollars to fight a case we might not win on, when there's no skin off of any taxpayer's nose if they lose because it's the charter school's problem? So I don't see why we want to go into a fight that we don't have a dog in. And so when we know for a fact, if we get sued, we're going to pay. And we might not win. So why would we want to go into a dog fight on the taxpayers' dollars when, regardless of what happens over there, the contract's clear that the sponsor's held harmless? So I feel like this is something that, you know, our schools, all of our school, you know, across the district, we've had issues where we've had, you know, teachers that have not done what they were supposed to do. And I'm not going to sit here and name them all, but I could name a bunch. If their insurance is high, well, we just spread it out and we cover it, or we've got a lot of schools insured, and so the insurance company can kind of give us a little break to get our business. The charter school doesn't have that option. They're kind of stuck because they're a one-man show. And so they're stuck with that. And it's very unfortunate that this happened to the school. And it's caused them a lot of problems because a teacher didn't do what they were supposed to do. But teachers don't do what they're supposed to do in other schools also. But there's enough PR that we keep it kind of covered up. But it came out at the charter school because it was smaller in numbers. But it came out and bigger, you know, and because it happened to them, it came out really, really big, because it wasn't like we have lawyers and stuff in our district to kind of make sure that, well, it goes over to this department or that department, let it be handled. And so it's unfortunate that this school had an employee that was a great employee, I think was even a military employee or something, and goodness gracious what happened. But I think that the school has been punished enough for that. It's not like they did anything wrong. They had one person that screwed up that's caused them tons of problems, and that's what the problem is here. And so I would like to ask my school board members to think about the fact that we are held harmless. We have no dog in this fight, and I don't know why we want to get in and fight it and spend taxpayer dollars fighting a fight that we don't have a dog in. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Stacy. Mr. Superintendent, I would like to call Ms. Lively up, and if she can give us an explanation of what has transpired and what is the reason behind the increased limit.
As been discussed, we've asked for these limits for many years, and the charter school has supplied these limits. What I understand has happened with them, as Ms. Stacy indicated, oftentimes you can get what they call a package policy, where all of your coverage will be put under one particular line of coverage, and it may cost pennies on the dollar to add different coverage like the sexual abuse coverage. And they were not able to do that this year, in large part due to their claims history. When they searched the marketplace, they could not find an underwriter that would agree to write their policy as previously written. Cost-wise, I don't have any idea how much it would be for them. I don't really get involved in that aspect. I'm sure it would be costly, but that's due to the circumstances that they have. So instead, they were able to procure the $300,000. However, again, the other schools do supply the $1 million limits. This school has for many years up until this year. So we would have an inequitable situation in terms of the other charters supplying it, and the school, for the very fact that they've had a claim, not supplying it.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Lavin. Mr. James, and then you and Stacy.
One thing I just, Laura, thanks for the information. One thing I just would like to just make sure I'm heard on what is occurring here now. Whether it's a charter school or not, when you take our kids and move them there, they're still our kids. Whether we like it or not, charter schools still fall under our jurisdiction, and those are our kids. If something happened to, if that school closed tomorrow, they would be back, so they're our kids. So let's don't try and play this on me now. It's important for us to understand that liability, whether we use it one time or 100 times, it's important that we have the proper amount. I understand what occurred over there, but I understand over the years that we've had problems in the school district. But it's almost universal, and we have been prepared for those incidents. It's the same as we may not have a hurricane for another year or two or three years, but we need to be prepared for that. I feel the same way about charter schools. Now, what I've heard is that the middle school have this. Is that correct?
Correct. Okay. When they separated off and procured their own insurance this year, they did get the $1 million, and the other schools have as well. And to the point about them holding us harmless, I think the concept would be, as the sponsor, we want to see them succeed, and to have the proper insurance protects them financially in the event that they have unexpected losses, and that helps them stay solvent and continue to operate. So even though it sounds like it's a negative situation, it really is for their benefit, so that they can continue to operate and protect themselves accordingly. It's kind of ironic at some level that for the reason they can't get the insurance, now they want to be able to get lower insurance. It was an unfortunate situation that they've had the claim, but they have.
Okay, and what I'm hearing is, if we do this, then we should also lower it for the
schools.
No, wait. Well, I still got it now. When I look at what we're doing, and I look at where we are in terms of this issue right here, board, I strongly believe that we need to hold with what we have in the past, because this is a classic example. Something happened at the school. We had no control over it. The staff had no control over it, but it happened. We were prepared to deal with that. If something happened again, which we have no control over, we need to be prepared to do that. And as long as I remember, we have had that $1 million policy. And I would hate for us to, for some reason, to change it because something happened, and all of a sudden we lowered the price in the policy. I have a hard time with that one.
Thank you, Mr. James. Ms. Stacy?
No, Mr. James, this would not affect the other schools because they have a contract that says they pay $1 million. This school does not have a contract where they pay $1 million. This school's contract doesn't have, it just says they will provide the coverage. So no, this would not affect the other schools at all because their contracts are clear. And it is nice. I mean, I would like to say, you know, that to everybody up here, I think we should, I think it's good for you, Ms. King, if you had a $2 million general umbrella
liability policy to cover you. I think you need to have it because I think you need to have it.
That's what we're saying, Ms. Lively. Just because we think they should have it doesn't mean they should have to have it.
Well, as we talked about,
our contract doesn't state it. Our contract, now, if one of the other charter schools, Mr. James, went to court over this, yeah, they would lose because it says $1 million. This would be in the gray zone because they've been supplying it, but it came as a commercial package, like Mrs. Lively said. But the contract doesn't have it. We could spend a lot of money fighting this and still might lose because this is in the gray zone. This is not an open and door shut contract. Our attorney's already shared that with me. We might win, we might not. But do we really want to spend taxpayer dollars because we did not, as a board, put a proper contract together and did this contract, if that's what we wanted there, we should have put it there, but we didn't put it there. And just because the blanket umbrella policy has provided that, like you shared with pennies on the dollar for it, until an incident happened, well then we all know that with car insurance, as soon as an incident happens, boom, you know, we gotta drop our coverage, just like this. When we get a car insurance problem, we drop our coverage and it affects us. It doesn't affect, my mom would love for me to keep the coverage up, but you know, We're the charter school's mom and dad. Sure, we'd like for them to keep the coverage, but they can't afford it. Just like I can't make my children keep coverage I can't afford. And especially when this contract does not say it. It's not in black and white. And also, but what the contract does say is that the Marion County School Board will not unreasonably withhold insurance acceptance. They have provided a policy. It's not what we want to have. But we did not designate an amount when we wrote this contract. But we did at all the other charter schools. That's our bad, okay? That's our bad loophole here. But that loophole could cost the taxpayers a lot of money if this charter school took us to court over that.
What I'd like to say about the contract, as Mr. Lake said, if that's the perception at this moment that it's gray, then obviously that's where we stand. But the intention with it is that the sexual abuse followed the $1 million limits that's within the box on the very top, that it could be endorsed to that policy. So while it may not be as clear as everybody would like it to be, that was clearly the intention. And every year the charter schools, all of them, get a letter from me that indicates all the coverages they have to have and asking if they have any change of scope and services so we can continuously monitor their insurance needs. They've received a letter every year and they've complied every year. So I find it hard to believe that just based on the contract, now all of a sudden there's an issue procuring the insurance.
Well, Mrs. Lively, if it has been no really additional charge, why would they say, no, $1 million cost me basically, what, $300,000 for, so I only want the $300,000. If they can work it into an umbrella policy, of course they got it. And, you know, when you write the district, okay, fine, it kind of, there's like a commercial policy that all the charter schools kind of get it, and I wouldn't be surprised if they didn't get it all from the same company. I wouldn't, you know, be surprised if they didn't, a lot of them share the same company and they got it. But when an incident happens, you know, and you said what the intent was, okay? The intent of the law, if it's not written in the statute right, and the legislature goes, well, the intent was this. Well, I'm sorry, that's not the way you wrote it in the law. Intent is not law. And so I don't believe that this school board should be run by crystal ball. I don't believe that people who have contracts with us should have to have a crystal ball to decide what we meant. And so if there is no amount here, this will cost the taxpayers dollars. If we work with the charter school this year, and maybe we can even help them find an insurance carrier that will give whatever you want, but it won't affect the taxpayers because it'll be the charter school's problem. It won't be our problem. But I guarantee you it is the taxpayers' problem because we didn't do this contract right. We wrote this contract based upon intent. That didn't stand up in court. Okay?
Mr. Lake?
I just wanted to clarify. I think if the speakers have done a good job about identifying the various issues here. I would say the strongest argument on both sides is this, in favor of upholding a requirement to pay the premium for $1 million would be the party's course of performance over the last 6 years, which has indicated that the parties clearly intended that be a term and part of the contract. On the other side, of course, is the fact that the contract is silent as to exactly what the amount of the general liability coverage would be for sexual abuse, molestation, and harassment. So there is some ambiguity there. So that's why you need a full analysis of this. The majority rule followed in Florida is that generally to interpret a contract, you don't just look at the four corners. You do look at the party's course of performance over the years. So there are substantial arguments on both sides of the issue. So you can, that's why it's not susceptible of a yes or no answer, in my opinion.
Thank you, sir.
Ms. Bailey?
I'm a rule follower, and I believe we require something of the other charter schools as far as million-dollar limits on premium liability coverage. We should not make an exception. We start doing that, and the other charter schools are going to be coming right where you are to ask for an exception as well. So I believe we need to, you know, keep all of the schools at the same coverage.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Stacy.
Except the other schools don't have this contract, Ms. Ely. The other schools don't have this contract. This has absolutely nothing to do. There is no amount written here, and all the other schools do have an amount.
Thank you.
It has absolutely apples for oranges comparison.
Ms. Lively, we appreciate you coming up and
giving us your
overview of that. Thank you so much. Mr. Dominguez, just one moment.
If I may, Ms. Boyden, the only thing, please, on this certificate of insurance, you pay attention to, we've got six insurance companies that we had to get to cover what we've got. Couldn't get it in one. Nobody wants to touch us because of what happened. And we're suffering from that. Now, it may take another year before we can go back and do the $1 million. But right now, this is the best I can get. We can't afford $100,000. I mean, that's 20% of our revenue. And, you know, we're already 75% of district. So what can I ask for?
Unreasonably withhold insurance acceptance.
We have a decision to make, or we can delay the decision making, or we can refer the entire dispute to the dispute resolution process. So we have three things we can do. So
I would recommend that the parties follow the process in the dispute resolution provisions.
I have no problem with that.
All right, if you could do that for us, Mr. Dominguez.
I will be agreeable to a dispute resolution.
Mr. Superintendent?
Mr. Lake, could you share with the public and the board the time frame involved in that dispute resolution?
Well, as I read it, I don't see that there is a time frame.
But if not, I would suggest the board discuss that tonight and set one since we have school starting for the charter school on the 24th.
Now, while it does identify four steps, it's silent as to how long each of these should take. So I would imply a reasonableness requirement in there. So whatever we determine as a reasonable time for each of these steps to be completed.
So, board, I'm thinking that school starts within a week, and maybe we need to start the process this week, Mr. Dementis, if we could.
Well, I don't think it, I think Mr. Lake will agree, I don't think it's going to take a day.
Do you have any insurance at all, or is it just you just have a quote?
No, I have, you're talking about the quote for the $1 million?
No.
We have all
the... So you have, this is what you have?
Yeah, we have insurance now.
Okay.
No, we're covered.
They have a certificate of liability for $100,000 for that particular category.
Okay.
They have turned that into risk management. I'm not sure who is involved in this. Before we leave this topic, we need to set some timelines, assign some tasks as to who's going to do what, who sits at the mediation, and we don't need to let the cameras go off before that's resolved tonight because of the time frame we're under. And I'll look to our attorney and board members for.
Well, step one is the informal discussion between the charter school and the school board representative regarding the issue. So I think you've already brought your dispute to us. The step two would be a written notice by the school board or the charter school outlining the nature of the issue. And then we'll have a meeting between the school board, the charter school, and the school board representative to discuss the issue and any modifications if needed to this charter. And then it says the fourth step says that the dispute resolution procedure is found in Florida statute. So I think, Mr. Dominguez, you met step one, and step two, you communicate it with the district, am I right?
That's what you call I did today, yeah.
Well, I would say step two, where it says written notice by the school board outlining the nature of the issue, I think it should be more of a formal document which outlines the issue and the reasons for the district's position, and then also the charter school putting in writing the reasons for their action or non-action. And then based on that, I mean, that can take, you know, relatively few days, you know, maybe three business days, and then set a meeting maybe next week to have representatives actually sit down in a room and talk about it.
Thank you, Mr. Lake. So based on Mr. Lake's recommendation that a written notice outlining the issues should be given, and I think we can get that within 3 days to you, and then we can, I think today we can set a meeting. Ms. Stacy?
I'm about to ask the attorney a point blank question. If this does go to court, will we win? That's a yes or no.
I'm sorry, what?
If this does go to court based upon the gray contract, will we win?
Oh, I'm not going to prognosticate on a question like that, nor do I think this would even end up in court.
Are you sure? Let me reframe that.
Madam Chair, I don't think this is an appropriate question to pose to the school attorney in this forum.
Okay, but if something does happen at the school, do you believe we're not indemnified? I mean, do you believe we're held harmless based upon this contract? If something happens there.
Certainly, there's a contract provision that states that the charter school will hold the district harmless.
The sponsor.
Assuming it has the assets to do that, sure.
So if something should happen at the school with this lower level, we are not held responsible. But if it goes to court, the taxpayers will pay. That's a fact. Thank you.
If I may, Ms. Boynton, the last item I gave you all was an excerpt from the Senate regarding indemnity of school boards.
The what?
Okay. In fact, Florida indemnity. And it's long read. I don't expect you to read it now. But basically, the state says the school district is indemnified from liability and all the rest of the things that you can read it all in this good night's sleep. Okay. Basically, my next question is, you know, if we're getting into discussion, do I have to hire legal counsel? And then we're, you know, I don't want to spend money. That's part of the problem we have here. I can't afford to spend $400 an hour for an attorney.
Mr. Dominguez, the board has not decided about any legal.
I know, and I'm saying that the dispute resolution, I don't mind working with someone to get it resolved. But at this point, you know, the impression I'm getting is y'all are saying, I've got to have $1 million, and I'm saying, then I can't get it, so what are you going to do?
So let me help you with this issue for a second. Mr. James, because if you met separately, we would have to call a special meeting if we wanted Mr. Dominguez to come back before the board or we resolve the issue tonight. We can have a vote tonight whether or not we want to uphold what the district has said to this charter school. You know, even though the contract to the charter school it's ambiguous, as it says, you know, it's a little shady. I think that either we follow the resolution, the dispute resolution, or we just vote tonight. Does anybody agree with me on that?
I believe we should follow the contract. It's got four steps.
And Mr. Dominguez has already agreed on the dispute resolution. So.
Well, that's fine. He can have it. He can agree on it. But I feel very strongly that if we have one person doing one thing, and all of our charter schools are doing something, then all of them should be doing the same thing. Now, we can, the issue here is the fact that we can't afford it. That's what I'm hearing here. If he could afford it, then he would have $1 million. So that's what the issue is. The fact that if that school opened and something happened on that campus, and we've been in enough lawsuits around here to know that we don't get anything under $100,000. Very seldom do we settle for anything under $100,000. So why are we saying to ourselves, okay, this incident did not occur at the charter school when we know it did? And if I was a insurance company, and I have a track record of saying on a person that have accidents for some reason, the tuition should go up, or it would go up. Okay, so what I am saying here, we can go to resolutions, but are we going to resolute everybody here that's sitting around with the same? Now, this is what this is to me. Now, we can go and go to a resolution, but I'm going to come back and I'm going to tell you, I'm going to say the same thing. What I'm saying right now.
Yes, well, I.
Okay, Ms. King, do you want to weigh in?
I'll weigh in. Of course, we want $1 million, and every other school is. But what I'm looking at is this what we have in writing. And what we have in writing, it doesn't have an amount. So in the future, are we going to be able to tell somebody else, like, well, we changed our mind? You know, it's just, I think you used the correct word, it's ambiguous. And it is between a rock and a hard spot. But if it's not in writing, I don't see how that's contract, you know, it's legit. It would have to be here. And what is in writing is that the board is unreasonably withhold its insurance or whatever, and we would not be wherever it is. We'd be held accountable or responsible. And that's what, you know, I see.
Okay. Thank you. Go ahead, Ms. Stacy.
It also says the Marion County School Board will not unreasonably withhold insurance acceptance. I believe we're being unreasonable because, first of all, this is the only charter school that does not require $1 million. So what we do with this school does not have any effect on the others whatsoever. And also, it says here that we will not be unreasonable. I believe we are being unreasonable because something happened at the charter school that has happened to our schools also. And how would we like the Marion County Public School System shut down because we can't afford insurance and the taxpayers won't give us a raise?
Are we shutting down?
If you withhold this money, yeah.
Well,
I mean, would you like to be shut down?
Wait a minute. Let me finish.
Just
now, if it's being shut down, there's got to be some other reasons there. Well, there got to be some other reason there.
I don't think there was a mention of your school being shut down, right, Mr. Dementis?
No.
Okay, it's the only thing you're bringing to us is the cost of the insurance is a little too high.
Exactly.
Okay.
Mr. Dementis, you did, I believe, say that you would not be able to open if you had to pay that premium, did you not?
I said I don't have the money to pay that premium.
So you would not be able to open if you were required to have that premium?
If you require us to have it, I've got a problem.
Thank you.
Kids are really counting on the school.
Okay. Excuse me, I want to write this down, you know.
Please. My memory is not like it used to be.
All right, okay. So, Mr. Dementis has he's clarified this. If we don't, as a board, and because school will open next week.
Yeah, we'll, yeah. We can open. We can open. We can open, but if you insist on $1 million policy, you're gonna tell us that until I get it, I can't open. I don't see how it's gonna work.
Okay, so Mr. Stace, Mr. James, you agree with the speak resolution? I understand that your opinion would be the same.
Okay, and let me ask this question. Did they not get a notice from Mrs. Lively about the $1 million?
Yes, they did.
Did she provide it every year?
Is that right? They did.
So it's not anything new, right? We can go through a resolution, but I am saying that they need to do what we asked them to do in reference to $1 million.
But it doesn't say that they're supposed to do this. If that's what we wanted, we should have put that in our contract when we wrote it, like we did all the rest of the contracts.
Mr. James, in answer to part of your question, I have never received anything from Ms. Lively except for last week. Never. The 6 years that I've run that school, the principals always took care of dealing with the insurance agent. I never did. And it wasn't until this letter and my dealing with Bird Insurance, when they told me I couldn't get it, I went to the contract. Up to that point, I never paid attention to the contract. So we were doing it because it was insurance company said, I mean, agent said, this is fine, you can do this. They may have talked to Ms. Lively. I never did. So I got caught with the situation, I had to get insurance. And then when I went in to look at the contract to make sure I was meeting what the contract said, then I found that there was no amount on there. So I went back to Bird Insurance. I said, what can you do for me? Said, the best I could do is 100, 300.
Now, if you look at that state statute, which talks about insurance, they say it's 100, 200 now for the indemnity. I can't remember the actual phrase, but 100, 300, and now I'm talking to the attorneys that are handling our case, and they claim that they're going to probably get away with 50,000. So what am I going to say? I don't know. Maybe it's going to be 100, but it's not going to be $1 million.
Okay.
Okay. Mr. James?
If mediation is what we need to do to get to this point again, then let's do that.
Okay, so let me recommend that next Tuesday that there be a meeting between the charter school and a school board representative to discuss the issue and any modification. And there may be some discussion on modifications to the charter, and that's what your contract says when you go through this.
I'll go through the contract again and make sure.
Okay. So is that okay? And maybe I appoint the person to sit through the mediation board? Ms. Healy?
Just to clarify, this would not be a mediation.
Well, this would be a resolution.
An informal conference.
Yeah.
Mediation would require actually obtaining the services of a partial third party to hear the dispute and then try to conciliate the conflict and reach a resolution.
Okay.
We're not to that point yet.
Well, we're just going to have an informal conference, informal meeting between the charter school and the school board representative. I'd like to appoint you, Mr. James, to be that. To represent the school board on that.
To be honest with you, I'd like to defer that to Mrs. King.
Mrs. King, would you be willing to serve and meet with Mr. Dominguez? It will be next Tuesday, and you, I would say, here in this boardroom, maybe about 1 o'clock, if that's possible.
Tuesday, 1 o'clock.
1 o'clock, Tuesday, 1 o'clock.
Sure.
Does that meeting, I have a question though, Mr. Lake, does that meeting have to be advertised or anything along those lines?
I don't believe so. Okay. It's not a...
Is there a step before that in which the school board is supposed to reply in writing?
Right.
Yeah, well, right. Step two says written notice by the school board outlining the nature of the issue. I can certainly prepare something that outlines what the issues are.
Okay.
All right.
And then the charter school, I think, would respond with their summary of the issues, just sort of to make sure that the conversation in the meeting follows, you know, the issues.
And that happens prior to Tuesday, those two epistles trade hands?
Yes.
And that's a private meeting.
As we look to the future beyond that, what is the next step after a meeting, whatever the...
I think the representatives of the meeting would then advise everybody as to what happened, I guess.
Mr. Lake, will you be at that meeting?
I don't know. I'll need to talk to the chair.
I was going to see if not only would Mr. Lake be there, but maybe Ms. Lively could be there too, Mr. Superintendent. I think it would be helpful because just in case our board member has any questions for the attorney to be there, as well as some staff member to be there.
Okay. Then okay. Would it be all right if I bring an attorney as well?
Yes, sir.
I really don't like to get into this.
Well, I guess my druthers is to keep attorneys out of stuff as much as possible, because once you lawyer up, then things get very legal.
I agree.
So then maybe we'll just have the Ms. Lively, her department, maybe Mr. Christian could be there, or whoever you find designate, Mr. Superintendent.
Well, Mrs. Lively will certainly be our representative because she's the expert in that field.
Okay, that way Ms. King can ask her questions along the way, and so we won't have our attorney yet.
Thank you very much.
I'll also outline what the dispute resolution procedure in the Florida statute is, should that meeting prove unsuccessful in resolving it, and I can outline the steps of the statute then sets forth, which I know includes mediation as one of those steps.
Okay, is that fair, Mr.?
Thank you very much.
I'd like to have some points of clarification. That is the 18th, is a Tuesday. School starts for Francis Marion Military Academy on the 24th. I do not know whether There is a timeframe there in which the board would like to demand an ending to this. The next time you meet as a board would not be until the 25th, in which either Mrs. King or Mr. Lake would, I assume, make some sort of report back here. What is your pleasure in reference to the school, the first day of school being the 24th, and starting school or not starting school with or without the million-dollar policy?
Mr. Tomlin.
I was addressing the board, sir.
Just a moment, sir.
We're starting the 17th.
You start on the 17th?
Yep.
He starts on the 17th, sir.
Next Monday.
Will we change from Tuesday to Monday?
He's saying school starting the 17th.
Oh, I'm sorry, you start the 17th?
Yes, sir.
All right, then that's the, I thought the school was starting the 24th, my mistake. Then the question is, we're not even beginning this mediation resolution or resolution mechanism until after. Do you wish to permit the school to start at their regular time? I think you would need to weigh into that so they're starting without the prescribed policy.
All right, board.
They do have insurance coverage.
Excuse me, Ms. Stacy. All right, board, we need to decide whether or not we will allow Francis Marion Military Academy to open on the 17th with the insurance that they have, with an understanding that the decision could change based on the findings between the meeting and the decision of the board. Okay. So, board, would you vote? Can you?
That's your, I think, a consensus.
Yeah.
Would.
I can go with that.
Okay, all right. So
perhaps Mr. Lake can address that in his summary comments, and even in the letter, since that is a point of contention.
All right. Okay, so you will be allowed to open on the 17th.
All right, I'll do that.
Temporary.
Okay, now, I just want to make sure now, you know, when we open on the 17th, and if the ruling does not come back in favor of us reducing this, I know we need to be prepared to take some steps here now, because I will tell you again now, usually if something happened, we have not settled for anything under $100,000.
That's right.
So I know if we open the school, we will be insured. And when I say I know, going through this process.
All right, so. I'm sure that Mrs. King will cover most of those things with Mr. Demensis, as well as Ms. Lively, who's well-versed in this insurance and in risk management. So, and I would hope that you would probably have a meeting with Ms. Lively before your meeting, Mrs. King. That would help you out a lot. Mrs. Stacy, you did have something to say. I'm not overlooking you.
Again, if it's the $100,000, we have no dog in the fight. It won't affect us at all. Whatever happens, it does not affect this board. It does not affect the taxpayers, period. So this is a charter school. The schools were set up for the intent of the government of the state of Florida, which they put their intent clearly in writing, obviously, because they will operate separate and apart in this area, and that's the way the law was written, so that they could operate independently. And the charter schools can't afford sometimes some of the things that the public schools can afford. And I think that if it looked like we were all going to close all these doors here, if we had to pay a $1 billion insurance policy, we would be looking at this a whole lot different. And so that's the reason, you know, I'm sure in the contract it actually says the Marion County School Board will not unreasonably withhold insurance acceptance. This does not affect us at all. The school board, we are the sponsor only, and any claim against the school goes against the school. It does not go against us at all. Our contract is doesn't say he has to have it. He's been doing it just because he didn't check his contract. Maybe if you checked your contract, you'd have done less than before. But you know, we can't run a school district based upon what someone in the insurance department intended for us to be. It's either here or it isn't. I ran a construction company. If it wasn't in the contract, I don't care what you meant. When I had a change order signed, you signed for this amount, you paid it. I don't care if you didn't mean to sign it, you signed it.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Stacy. And also, board, I would ask our board attorney, if you could look at our contract with this charter school and other charter schools and make recommendations for changes for risk management purposes, please.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Dementis.
Thank you, Ms. Boynton. Thank you, Board.
Madam Secretary.
Mrs. Murray.
My name is Sharon Murray. My address is M-U-R-R-Y. My address is 9264 Southeast 72nd Avenue, Ocala, Florida 34472. I am the chairman of the Francis Marion Military School Board. I came here today intending to talk about something that happened this morning and to say some negative things about Mr. Dementis. But first, I need to say some positive things. I tried to get this insurance along with the high school because we were together when we started the insurance business, and he is right. He can't get insurance for less than $79,000. The only reason we got insurance for $16,000 is because I said, look, we have to get it. Lori said we have to have it. We need a separate policy, and we got it for $16,000. I was on the high school board until July of this year. I know a little bit about their finances. If you can't come to some accommodation about this insurance, you will bankrupt the school. In my opinion, reasonably informed, they don't have the money to pay $79,000 for insurance. You could maybe amend their charter for this year, and I'm not going to make recommendations to you because that's not my business, but I sat there and I thought, I know they can't pay that. And I was just sick. All that having been said, I came to talk to you this morning about an altercation on the grounds of the Francis Marion Schools, which you may have heard about. And if you haven't, you will certainly hear about it in the morning because this gentleman was there and so were a lot of police. Mr. Tom Adair, the manager of the school, informed the middle school board. On Friday, Charles Dementis said to me, unless you pay me $15,900 in a cashier's check by 4 o'clock today, I'm gonna close the campus to your employees, your volunteers, and your students. So I sent him a note back that said, you can't do that because we need a 30-day notice. And if you send me a notice that's notarized, then I will respond within 30 days and we'll find a place to take our 100 plus middle school kids. Monday I went to school and nothing happened and I was glad. Today I wasn't at school and I got a call. Our secretary was crying in the parking lot. They told her she couldn't go into the building except to get her personal effects and she could leave. Now, this is August. We have over 120 children who need to have classrooms and a certified teacher by the opening of school. And this gentleman says, you can't go in there. So I know the reason for that. It's a long story, which you don't have time because you've already dealt too long with something that wasn't on your agenda. But the bottom line is, I was the person who brought the mismanagement of funds allegations against Mr. Dementis and when he was the chairman of the middle school board. I still believe that. He says we owe him $15,900. I know that he owes the middle school at least $18,000. And as the audit numbers are collected, I'm almost positive. No, I know the numbers are going to be more than that. So I wasn't willing to pay him the money. Three times he said, pay me money. And I said, wait till the auditors are finished. And finally, he had had enough, and that's what happened today. I don't expect the school board to do anything about that. I don't know that it's your place to do it, but I do think you need to know about it. You know, we're on the other side of a contract with you, just like the high school's on the other side of a contract with you. But it is appalling, and when it's in the paper tomorrow, you will hear about it. Now, we think that we can solve our problem. We've been working. This gives us a little less time to do what we need to do, but I believe we will find a place for all of those people to sit in a classroom on the first day of school. Our school starts the 24th. Whether it will be where we're going to stay for the year, I don't know. But there was a brouhaha, and there will probably continue to be an altercation between the high school board and the middle school board until we resolve, till the auditors are finished resolving their issues. I have one more thing to say, and that is we've been very pleased with the professionalism of Alice Posada and her crew. They were very, very good, very knowledgeable. They worked really well with the people in the middle school, and we expect that what comes out of that will be a good audit. We also were told we needed to have an outside audit. We had one scheduled, but they came to see us about the scope of the audit on the day that the newspaper article about our schools appeared. And the auditor backed up so fast, I thought he was going to kick himself on the door as he went through it backwards. We did find another auditor. We have made an arrangement to meet with them next week. We will have the audit done. We obviously are not going to make the 15th of August, but we will have it done as soon as possible.
Ms. Murray, I want to thank you for bringing it to our attention. We really appreciate your concern and making sure that we as a board were informed on everything. At this time, I'm sure some of the other board members may have some questions, so I'm going to go with Ms. Stacy.
I guess it's when the two schools opened on the same campus under two different schools, instead of being a combination of one school and opening as two independent schools, it's kind of hard when you have two parents under one roof. And I wondered about that because I was concerned how it was going to work. How were you going to share busing and share everything? Because it was just hard, you know, to figure out how you would break it out. I was sitting here as a business person wondering how you were going to do it. And, you know, I think a lot of the emotional stuff's gone on over there. A lot of that's happened. And I don't know how, and this board, I don't know, there may be people on the board that's willing to kind of go in and kind of stand between, you know, the dog and the tree. And maybe help y'all rekindle your working relationship. I don't know if that's possible. Do you believe it's possible?
I think it will be easier when we're on separate sites.
I think it's hard for two families to live in the same house.
And I think that what happened was we had a business where we had two schools and we had one chair. And one school said, I need to have the other school pay me money. And so the chair of the first school said to himself, I need to have this school pay me money. It's easy to commingle funds under those circumstances. And I only can think of one instance that I am sure is that I allege is fraud. I think most of it was commingling funds and not paying enough attention to coding. I don't know that, but we did rebookkeep everything when I took over. I'm retired military. First thing they said was, if you take over an organization, you check the books. And so in checking the books and getting ready for the audit, then I found things, and then I talked to people, and that's when we came to see you, because I had concerns about irregularities. And I don't know how you deal with which kinds of irregularities in the school system. I haven't been a chairman of a public middle school board before, and I'm not sure what all the rules are. But I do know that if one organization has responsibilities to pay for something, that organization should pay for it.
Because what I'm looking at more than anything else is that we talk about the insurance and how much it costs. We talk about $18,000 what here. We need to as a board, we need to go ahead and just get to the bottom of this whole thing. And if we bring in, and I know Alice and those guys, and I love them, but we need to get some impartial people in here and let them just clean this thing up so we can know where we're going.
All right.
And I would like to make a recommendation to this board that we fund some outside auditors to come in and go through this and just try and get this thing back on the right plane.
Right,
because
right track.
Because when Frances Marion first started, they had some problems in terms of filling out the paperwork. We need to go ahead and make sure we set the foundation right in this thing. And what I'm hearing is this is an ideal time to do this.
All right. Board, you've heard Mr. James' recommendation. Are you in agreement with it? And how much do you think we should do? Should we have a limit on how much you're willing to spend?
All depends on who we get and how good they are.
Yeah.
Let's figure out.
I think it's difficult to set a limit here at a board meeting. I agree with Mr. James. We need to get an outside auditor.
Right, yeah, I agree too, Mr.
I do have some information for the board relative to that. And talking with Mrs. Corgan and Ms. Posada, who have done their review, they are continuing to see additional concerns, ones that they have recommended to me that we do pursue an outside CPA firm to come in and do an audit, which makes total sense to me. We have contacted Purvis Gray, who does our audit for us and does a number of audits, and we have come to an agreement that they would come in. They can't drop everything they're doing, but they would come in probably beginning at the end of next week, and or at the very earliest, and they would use our standard rate. They are not going to give us an estimate right now, but I do know that our folks, Christine Corgan and Alice Posada, will work, and Susan Johnson also will work very closely with them, so they don't have to discover everything. We will give them the information that we have found thus far, which will expedite the situation and also be a reduced cost for us. But I think, and I agree with Mr. James, and I was prepared. That was the last thing I was going to mention to you tonight, and I don't have to do that now. I'll try to end on a happier note. Mm-hmm. But that's very important for us to do. These are our children. These are our funds. These are our taxpayers that are supporting this. These are our volunteers that are working in the system. And I think that the school system does have an obligation to come out with a serious audit. Now, board, I don't know how the audit is going to end up. It could be favorable, it could be unfavorable, it could be, it could cite a number of things. At that time, at least, you will be at least equipped with an impartial assessment of what's going on there and will be able to make a decision relative to both of those schools, and they will be dealt with independently and not together.
Thank you, Mr. Superintendent. Mrs. Stacy, you have a question or?
I think an audit's a good idea. In fact, there's a percentage of each student's money that's withheld by the district for to cover administrative costs. And, you know, I don't know, it's and for the administrative costs. And I believe that this, over the many, many years that the charter schools have been in place around here, that together they have paid a lot of money that's been extra in that fund. And I believe that we have the fund to cover this audit that's been built in, because we do keep, probably that's the reason the state sets aside money that the district gets to keep. What is it, 4%? There's a percentage.
We also pay our employees ongoing to be the middleman. This is Posada's salary, some of that. We have another employee that's assessed some of that.
Right.
But Ms. McKee's salary. We have a number of people's salary.
But we take, some districts don't take as much out as we do. We take the maximum amount. Some districts don't take the maximum amount on the administrative costs. So I believe that the coverage is there. And it would be great, because the allegations hurt, whether they're true or not, the allegations just hurt the school. And it would be nice to make a clean break and everybody get it back, because my only concern when this first started was with the two schools being together, and I didn't know how it was going to work. And I'm not surprised. And so I want to thank Mr. James for that recommendation. I think it's a great one. And when we can move forward to get the books perfect, and hopefully the two schools then can move forward and do what's great for because the military school is great for, you know, it's the kids are so patriotic, and it's such a great place for kids to go. And probably I would love to have one of my own children go to the military academy if I still had children in school today. And so there's a great reason to keep both of those schools in place. And if there's any way I can ever be any kind of go-between or sit between the group, I would be glad to do that. It's just a volunteer in the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Stacy. And so, board, we do have a unanimous consent for the district to have an independent auditor for Frances Marion Military Academy. Madam Secretary.
We have one additional speaker, but she's requested to be non-televised at the end of the meeting.
Okay, thank you so much.
I have a rhetorical question regarding...
Okay, go ahead.
It's a rhetorical, I don't really need an answer, but what if something happened at Francis Marion next week and there was a lawsuit, $300,000-$400,000? Who's going to be paying the difference if all we're covered for is $100,000?
Be the board of directors. I don't think who pays it, since we're held harmless.
No, go ahead.
That's okay, go
board
ahead.
Of directors, and they don't have it, so, okay.
It's the governing board is responsible
okay.
for all the debts of the school that aren't covered any other way.
Okay.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. So that was
board of directors. Okay.
That's not our problem.
Yeah, that was Ms. Murray.
Back on us.
Excuse me. That was Ms. Murray answering the question for Mrs. Ely. Ms. Murray is from Francis Marion Charter School, middle school charter school. Thank you so much, ma'am. All right. Board, any more discussion? Okay. Board, may I have a motion to approve the consent agenda with the exception of item C-49, which is the accelerated reader, which has been placed on the regular agenda for discussion. May I have a motion and a second, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved by Mr. James, seconded by Mrs. King. Is there any discussion? I call a question. All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. And the motion passes. May I have a motion to approve entering into a revised contract for sale and purchase of a 70-acre future middle school site located near the intersection of Oak Road and Silver Road in the Silver Spring Shores community. May I have a motion and a second, please?
So moved.
Moved by Mrs. Ely and seconded by Mr. James. Is there any discussion?
I think it's a great place, maybe not in my lifetime, but I think it's a perfect place for a middle school out there in the Shores. I love that piece of property, and it's a go.
Thank you, Ms. Ely. Mr. James, I'm sure you have something to say.
Well, we've been working at this for a long time.
We finally
when
got
I
it.
Say it's out in the Shores, and they have been waiting, mm-hmm. but now they know we are on the way. I don't know how long it's going to take, but we're on the way. We're on the way there, and it's an excellent piece of property, just like Ms. Ely has said. And I am so proud of the board that we're moving on to get to make this happen in the Shores. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. James. Mrs. Stacy, you have something to comment?
For those watching the television audience, we didn't just go out and buy a piece of property. Mr. Hurley, he is our person that goes and checks things out. He's a great planning person and has great experience at what he does. And I'm telling you, he'll give you the details to ad nauseum, but he's representing the taxpayers' interest completely. And we have had workshop after workshop. This has taken us a very long time, and I am very happy tonight to support this.
Thank you, Ms. Stacy. All right, you want to, do you have anything to say, Ms. King?
I don't.
Okay, I'm excited too. And I know the residents of Silver Springs, I'm sure, should be excited too. And I know the hard work Mr. Hurley, he did just to make this contract a good contract for the school board. Thank you, Mr. Hurley. I'll call the question. All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. And the motion passes 5-0.
School site DD.
Yes. Okay. May I have a motion to approve the renewal of Renaissance Learning, Inc. Accelerated Reader Enterprises as amended from quote 1455174. May I have a motion and a second, please?
Second.
It's been moved by Mrs. King and seconded by Mr. James. Mrs. Stacy, you withdrew this item. Do you have a
yes.
discussion?
The reason I withdrew this item is we have the principal of the year in the nation in our midst here in Marion County. And
she uses, I believe it's called Reading Plus, if I'm not right, Mr. Tomlin, you could correct me.
That is correct.
Reading Plus, in her school. I've spoken to St. John's County and even had their purchasing agent, just out of curiosity, see what a number one district uses for reading remediation in their district. And they've never purchased AR for high schoolers. I spoke with their reading specialist there, and he said that, you know, comes to the intrinsic and the extrinsic. The extrinsic motivation through AR works with young children, but really doesn't work with the older kids because they get more of an intrinsic thing. And that what they have found is that you can kind of game the system with AR. You can kind of game it, and you can kind of read things that are not to your level, and you can take a whole bunch of tests, and you can, you know, with the high school kids, because it's kind of, that goes to a computer, they read on the computer and they do it. With the elementary children, they just want to learn. They're not really that much to game in it, but like the high school kids are. But that's what their experience, you know, that's kind of their fear there. They do use it in their middle school some. Another thing that they do different, and I pulled it so I could talk about this with you, is they really don't purchase except for through Title I, and I know, you know, we're doing this through our textbook dollars, but that does hit our textbook budget. They have, a lot of these things are purchased through the school, through the budget of the school, through the 1-800 objects and or functions. And so it comes out of the school's budget. And I think if a school was funding some of this that's not paid by Title I, they would think a whole lot longer about whether they're going to buy something that's not going to work. And so, you know, we've spent like nearly $12,000 on something for two high schools that North Marion and Lake Weir, and apparently they're the only high schools using this. And from now on, I think as a school board member, I would like some justification as to why we use some of these things. When the rest of the high schools in the district are not using it, but we're gonna subject children to using it at certain schools. So even last year, I didn't know it was even gonna come back up in the high schools. I called Mrs. Elsperman just to talk to her after it was all settled and done. We had talked about AR for elementary children, which my children love because it has extrinsic benefits. And she told me, I don't believe AR works in high school. But she said, that's my personal opinion. And she said, we've had a lot of success with Reading Plus. And what I would like for our district to consider is looking at the schools that are having great success with their programs, especially when you have the Teacher of the Year for Florida, the Teacher of the Year for the nation, saying that Reading Plus is the way to go. I'd like to encourage our principals to maybe get with Mrs. Elsprin and find out really why she thinks Reading Plus is the way to go, because these children that are needing reading remediation, they're in trouble, and I don't think that we should be putting up a program before them that doesn't really have much of a track record. The number one district in the nation, in the state, doesn't use it. But that's, I mean, I'm going to, that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Mr. Superintendent?
Sure. And board members, I've already given to you the document that was attached to the original board packet did include two high schools, and that was an error on our part. You've received a revised bid sheet on your desk tonight. It eliminates the high schools. Our high schools did not use accelerated reader. We thank you, Ms. Stacy, for bringing that up, but our high schools do use Reading Plus, and I appreciate you taking a little bit of credit for that, but I will be giving credit to our K-12 academic services and our principals for choosing that. The accelerated reader program will continue to be used and district supported in our elementary and middle schools because it is a great motivational tool. The Reading Plus is an instructional tool. I mean, there is a big difference between those two. And I see Mrs. King pondering because I believe she understands that situation, having come recently from an elementary school. But again, you have the revised document. That's why the amendment, the motion on the floor is with the amended form. So you have that now, and appreciate your support for this.
And thank you, because we talked about this last year, a couple years ago we had this, and we were using it at the high schools, and I had the same issue with it. So I'm glad that we have finally discontinued it at the high schools.
Mr. James, do you have anything to say?
No question.
Okay, the question has been called. All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, like sign. And the motion carries 5-0. Board, may I have a motion to approve the following donations: $2,000 to Donnella Middle School from the Villages Entertainment, BOTV; $1,000 to Community Technical and Adult Education from Paul Wise; $1,270 to North Marion High School from One Blood Inc.; $10,650 to the Public Education Foundation of Marion County from Lockheed Martin Missile and Fire Control, $3,500 to Silver River Museum from the Cannon Law Firm. May I have a motion and a second, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved by Mrs. Ely, seconded by Mr. James. Is there any discussion? Call a question. All in favor of accepting the donation, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. And Ms. Stacy, I'm going to ask you this evening to give our thanks to our donors, please.
I will just thank my colleague who just passed the grand total of $18,420 of donations to our school district. Mrs. Ely so kind to add it up for us.
It sounds better rather than individually.
Yes, it does. And she gets real excited. She was a principal, and she knows how much this money means to the schools, probably more than I understand, because I've not been in her shoes before, trying to run a school with minimum dollars. And then it's so nice to have a bonus come that's like a gigantic allowance bonus that they get. And our community is so supportive, and I want to thank those who did help our schools. And these are people that gave us things. Nobody told them they had to do it. And, you know, sometimes it's so hard for us to give up our money, but these people give of their money. And it's so wonderful that there's so many wonderful people in Marion County, and I want to thank all of them for these donations. And, again, thank my colleague here for adding it up for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Stacy. For the next two administrative briefing and work sessions, we'll continue with the review of the budget and our schedule for Thursday, August 13th, and the following Thursday, which is August 20th, 2015 at 9 a.m. So we do have a meeting this Thursday, Board. Make sure you mark your calendars. In addition to the budget review, vocational programs will also be reviewed at the August 20th administrative briefing and work session. At this time, does any board member have a report or any concerns or comment? I'll start with you, Mrs. Stacy.
I want to share something on Westport High School. And I just put a mint in my mouth. Someone in the community called me today and said, I was standing behind a gentleman at the grocery store, and he had on a Westport t-shirt. And he said he kind of struck up a conversation with him in the grocery store line. And he said, do your kids go there, or are you involved with the football? And he goes, no, I'm a teacher. I teach at Westport, and I'm about to start back to school, and I'm so excited. And he said he just started getting all about it. And we've been in A school for 6 years. It's so nice to have our teachers so proud to go to work when you've got a school of excellence like that. And we've got, that is such a great place. Mrs. Elsprin's done such a great job, but we have other great high schools. My son graduated from a great high school here, but it's just so neat for a teacher to start bragging on the school's accolades. And I'm sure another school, if they are state champions, I know Forest High School, they're going to be state champion, they're state champions for the girls softball team. So it's really, really nice when our schools do something that's excellent, and each school has something I'm sure they're proud of. But it was really neat that someone in the community just called me because he was so impressed that our teacher was so excited about going back to work at Westport. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Stacy. Mrs. King.
Last week I went to the county commissioner's chambers, and because they were part of Stuff the Bus, and it was really nice to see our community work together for our students that need supplies the most. And it was really fun because when we were there, their staff had decorated different buses or trucks, and in their specific, I'm assuming it was probably different areas, they had their supplies in there. And then the county commissioners put on their backpacks and walked out to the bus and then gave the supplies. And it was just a lot of fun. And I would just like to tell them thank you, and we appreciate our relationship with them. So,
that's it. Mr. James?
I'm following the same line as Ms. King. One of the things I did was attend the backpack giveaway at Horizon on Saturday morning, and it was over 1,000 people out there, and they had so many different vendors out there working with people, and I got a chance to really go in the cafeteria and talk to Ms. Johnson, and all her staff was there working with people in terms of getting them ready for school. And I'd like to commend Mr. Sanford for really, and I'd have to say Mr. Trombley, because he was there with Sunrise. And I did not see Marion Oak, but it was really, they were there. It was a job well done, and I know the community is very proud of the turnout, and the backpacks was abundant, and there was enough left over to take to some of the back to their schools for the kids that were not able to attend. And I did have an opportunity to go through the Kroski Center, and again, it was one of those things where if you want to really get out and meet your constituents and look at some of those kids and look at their eagerness to go back to school, it was this amazing turnout. And again, I'd like to commend the Children Alliance and the whole staff out at Horizon and that whole end of the county for really putting on a good show for those kids. And it was really something. Hopefully, Mr. Superintendent, I missed you. Did you go down there?
Yes, sir. I was there.
Well, we were going through the wrong time.
Thank you, Mr. James. Mrs. Ely.
I am very excited to have all these new, energized first-year teachers that I visited last week. Met a gentleman, I said this last week, but it wasn't on TV, Donnellan Elementary. He's going to be third grade. He was so exuberant about coming back to school, couldn't wait to meet his kids, and the energy that those first-year teachers had was, I just hope we can bottle it and give it to all of our teachers. And I know we're still lacking for some teachers, but we'll be opening school with a lot of energized teachers, a lot of positive feeling, which is what we need to start with and continue throughout the year. I also took a bus ride on one of our new buses, of the 44 buses. And I took the route, for summer school route. Regina Taylor was the bus driver out at Lake Grove Middle. It was quite an event. She had the summer school kids from Bellevue Elementary. And I sat behind her on the bus, and a cute little girl came up to me and said, "You're in my seat." And so I moved over. And I said, "I'm sorry." I said, "Can I sit over here?" She said, "Yes." And then she proceeded to tell me that she's shy, and she talked the entire 45-minute trip. But it was really cute. And I also wanted to let you know the Pace Center has their graduation Thursday, and I plan to go represent the school board. I hope any of you can attend that, the graduation and transition ceremony. And last but not least, students, have a great year, and get to school on time every day, and it will be a great year. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Ely. Mr. Lake, the school board attorney.
Thank you. I think I probably said enough tonight. So.
Thank you so much, Mr. Superintendent.
Thank you, Chairman Boynton. Board members, please remember to bring your budget folders when you come to Thursday's work session. Mrs. Ellis and Mrs. Krasalka are working diligently to find as many answers to your questions that you have, and we'll have most of those answers for you also on Thursday. Marion County, in light of the fact that we have a lot of energized people back at work today, we still are experiencing the same things that the entire nation, state of Florida, is embracing right now, and that is a hiring shortage of qualified and certified teachers. We still have about 76 instructional openings right now. Our principals are scrambling to get those positions filled by next week. Again, our teachers did return yesterday, and they're pretty excited. You can feel it in the air. I visited about 10 schools yesterday. You've already echoed that. Our bus drivers came back to work today, almost 300 of them. We had an in-service training all day for them at MTI, and likewise, I think they're very happy to be back at work. The final thing I'll bring before you again, as you know, we have amended our school calendar for this year, and there was a major shift that week. Our principals and those teachers and employees that were impacted, we're working very smoothly through that process now. You know, they have an opportunity to take two or three options, or even to make up the days at the close of the school year, and everything's going very smooth with that. I do have one thing to ask of you, and you will see it on an upcoming board agenda. We are going to be required to make one more adjustment to our calendar. After you looked at it, after I've looked at it 100 times, and different people have looked at it 100 times, we made one other issue that I'm concerned about, and that is November the 11th, the traditional day that we experience and celebrate Veterans Day. We also listed that as an early release day. Well, that's not going to work for us because we bring tons of elementary kids and tons of middle school kids there. So that the change that you'll see recommended at our next board meeting will be that we just move that early release day to the 18th. It's not an issue. We have no contractual obligations with presenters or anything on that day, but you will see that, and I wanted to let you know about that ahead of time. That's all I have, ma'am.
All right, thank you, Madam Secretary. Brenda, do you have anything?
All
right, thank you. All right, board, I too was able to visit the new teacher orientation and found it to be a real exciting day for the new teachers, and staff was so excited that day. Even Kevin, I saw him around taking pictures. It was just a wonderful thing for our district to be able to hire new teachers. Also, I just want to remind you, if you would please give me more information, some feedback on those policy changes that I gave you the last time. I really would appreciate it very much. And thank you. Before adjourning the meeting, I wish to acknowledge that board members have received the alternative placement list for students through July 22nd, 2015. At the request of a parent, we are now concluding the televised portion of our meeting.